As you know, this course is Advanced Welding Technology. So in this course, we'll be discussing about different variants of welding. We have already discussed welding in an earlier course in your fourth semester, MEC 402. But there we have discussed with the very basics of welding, the most common types of welding and the very general things about welding. In this course, we'll talk about some higher variants, higher in the sense, higher capabilities, different type of parameters, different type of processes, those things we'll discuss. So as you may be knowing, if you have seen the syllabus, this is the syllabus, maybe two slides are there. So this is the first slide of the syllabus. So welding, we'll start with the definition of welding, requirements of welding, conditions of an ideal weld, and classification of welding processes. So these things we have done earlier also. In MEC 402, these things we have done. But we'll discuss it very little this time. Then we have electrodes, classification, nomenclature, basicity index, coating factor, and selection of electrodes. Out of these, few things we have done earlier also, like what are the role of different elements. So there are different elements which performs different functions. Some of the elements, they form slag. Some of the elements, they form the shielding gas, those sort of things. So this thing we have done. So role of different elements we have done earlier. Coating factor we have done earlier. So very basic definition of the coating factor is there. This time we'll be doing electrode classification. If you have used electrodes, you may be knowing that all the electrodes, they have a code associated with them, maybe a four-digit number. If you go for AWS classification, American Welding Society classification. So they have a four-digit number. So we'll see what does those digits mean. And we have our own system of classification, Indian Standards, Bureau of Indian Standards classification, BIS system we call it. So that classification also we'll see. Then we'll compare the two. Compare the Indian system of classification and the American system of classification. And then we'll see which one gives more information and which one is more prevalent. Those sort of things we'll see. Right, then arc welding, arc initiation, arc physics, these things we have done earlier. How does arc is initiated? What are the different methods to initiate an arc? What is meant by an arc? These things we have done. Arc physics, very basics we have seen. How does the arc starts? What are the ways by which the arc can be maintained? How the arc can be disturbed? Those sort of things we have done. This time we'll study the arc in a little more detail. We'll study the different zones inside the arc. There are basically five zones in an arc. We'll see what are those zones and those things we'll see. Arc maintenance, we have not done previously. This time we'll see it somehow. Power source and power factor and duty cycle. These things also we have done earlier, right? We have seen different types of power sources, constant current, constant voltage, then drooping characteristics, rising characteristics, these things we have seen. We have seen what is meant by power factor, what is meant by duty cycle, whether power factor should be high, whether duty cycle should be high. These things we have seen already. Also, we have seen GMAW, GTAW, and SAW. SMAW also we have seen this shielded metal arc welding. GMAW, just MIG, TIG, and SAW also we have seen. But we'll be discussing the other variants, electro slag welding, electro glass gas welding, PAW is plasma arc welding, AHW is atomic hydrogen welding. These things we'll see in detail. How do they work? How they're different from the already existing welding methods? Why they are needed? Those things we'll see. Then welding design and associated symbols. This we have not done earlier. So whatever portion we have done, I will just underline it. So this underlined portion we have covered already. Little we'll see about it. Very general thing we'll see, and we'll mostly concentrate on the non-underlined portion, right? Welding design and associated symbols. This we have not done at all. We'll see it. We'll see what is meant by welding design. If you see any manufacturing part planning, if you see, there we'll find that the welding operation is accompanied by a lot of symbols. So what is meant by those symbols? What does the different symbols signify? Those things we'll see. Then weld metallurgy, zones in and weld, we have seen earlier. Weld decay, we have seen earlier. Earlier means previous, MEC 402 we have seen. But this time we'll concentrate more on HAZ. We'll see the different zones in an HAZ. Very basic things we have seen earlier, but this time we'll see it in much more detail. Right. And then we'll do some numericals on HAZ calculations. How do we determine the thickness of the HAZ? Depending upon the current and voltage, we can find out the width of the HAZ. This we'll see. Weld distortion, we have to see. Well, distorting is wrong here. Distortion. Weld distortion, we have to see. Residual stresses, we have not done earlier. So we'll find out what are the causes of residual stresses. Why do we need to find out residual stresses? How do we find it out? How can we remove it? Those sort of things we'll see. Then we have the another section is solid state welding processes. Out of this, forge welding we have done. So forge welding, the basics of forge welding, different types of joint in forge welding we have seen. But cold welding, friction stir welding, these things we have not done earlier. We'll cover this in this course. Then thermochemical welding processes, we have thermite welding. Thermite welding we have seen previously. Very basic, we'll see this time also, but we won't concentrate much on it. Rather, we'll concentrate on ESW, EBW, and LBW, ultrasonic welding, electron beam welding, and laser beam welding. These are relatively newer variants of the welding process. So we'll see these processes in detail. What are the equipments? What are the process capabilities? How do we control the welding? These things we'll see in detail. Then the another section is welding at micro and nano scale. This we have not done at all. And this portion, I'm very sure you won't find in any of the books as well. This portion I tried to inculcate in this course and I was successful in it. So this portion is the cutting edge of welding, the current state of art in welding. We'll find out how can we do welding at micro and nano scale. When I say micro and nano scale, I mean we'll try to figure out how can we weld a 100 nanometer diameter wire. So that scale we are talking about, very elementary scale, but very interesting thing. So whatever we'll be discussing in this welding at micro and nano scale, these things are all taken from research papers. Not very latest, means 2012, 2013, 2008, 2009 research papers. Those research papers we'll see for welding at micro and nano scale. And then the last topic is automation in welding. So most of the welding nowadays, specifically in the automobile industry, whatever welding is done, those welding are automated. So we'll figure out how can we automate the welding process. What parameters can we automate in the welding process? How do we automate the welding process? Those things we'll try to figure out. Right. So these are the course content for this year's syllabus, this course's syllabus. Right. So today we'll just cover the, we'll just recap the basics which we have done in the previous course. We'll talk about welding, we'll talk about the basic welding processes, SMAW, GMAW, GTAW, just sort of recap so that from next class we can get into it, we can try and see the other welding processes, right? So welding, as we all may be knowing, if you have taken the notes, you know, it is a localized coalescence of metals, wherein the coalescence is achieved by heating to a suitable temperature with or without application of pressure, with or without application of filler. So we know filler material is the extra material other than the electrode. If we have a stick with us, that extra stick of the material is called as filler material. This is the extra material which is given to the weld joint other than the electrode, right? Through welding, we try to achieve a permanent joining between the two elements. And ideal welding is one in which the pieces which are joined, they should ideally behave as one, right? You have a part A, you join it with part B. Then after the joint is made, there should not be a distinction between part A and B. Both A and B should behave as a whole new entity. They should behave as one. So that is the perfect case of welding. After welding, there should be a complete continuity between the points joined, and every part of the joint should be indistinguishable. So you could have seen a lot of examples of welding processes where after the welding, it is very difficult to figure out where the welding has taken place. So that is the apex, that is the apex of welding, means that is the highest level of refinement that you can go in the welding process. So that there you cannot figure out whether welding has taken place or not. And the part will, if you put it in mechanical testings as well, even then the part will behave as one. So you cannot figure out where the welding has taken place. Whole complete body will behave as one object. Okay. So this is some example. Since we are having virtual lectures, so I can show you images. So this will be a recurring theme throughout this course. I will show you lots of images and videos also. Things which I cannot show in classroom, which is very difficult to show in classroom. I will try to show here, right? We are missing out on the classroom interaction, so I'll try to make up for it by showing you some images. Okay, so these are MS pieces, mild steel pieces, which are welded together. But this joint is not a very good joint. You can see some spatter is there. The weld bead which has been deposited is not continuous also. Some portion, specifically this portion. Okay, tell me one thing. When I move the cursor, can you see the cursor also? Anyone of you,
yes,
please?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, you can see the cursor also, right? Okay. So you can see that the weld bead which has been deposited is not continuous also. Some spatter is there and some portion has not been welded also, right? So this is not a very good weld. So many defects are there. Even through naked eye, we can see so many defects. Now, if you take a cross section and put it under microscope, I'm pretty sure you will find out porosity, blowhole and a lot of other things as well. So this is an example of a good weld. So again, same type of joint, T-section has been made, but this time the workpiece material is stainless steel. So stainless steel welding is even more difficult than MS welding. This, I think we have discussed earlier also. Stainless steel is a non-conductive thing. So whatever heat is being input, it does not conduct away easily. So even after the welding, the heat stays inside the material and then it tends to distort the material. When we'll be discussing the weld distortion, that time we'll figure this out, that how does heat, why heat can be a detrimental factor in welding. So, however, this is a example of a good welding. You can see there is a complete continuity and even through naked eye, it is sort of not that bad as the previous one. Sort of continuity is there. The weld has been deposited without any spatter. The bead is continuous. The complete joint has been made. So this is an example of a somewhat good weld. Right? This is another example of welding of pipes. So welding, when you talk about welding, the major application of welding is in either welding of pipes or welding of pressure vessels. These are the two areas or two arenas in which welding is extensively used. Because if you remember, I told you welding is a type of permanent joining method, which can be waterproof also. It can be welding is a joining method in which the two elements can be joined and then can be made waterproof also. So welding of pressure vessels, welding of boiler tanks is a very common thing which you will find in industry. Welding of pipes, of course, is another common thing. So here the pipe is being welded through some handheld process. Probably GTAW is being used, but seeing the thickness of the pipe, seeing the thickness of the deposition, maybe GMAW also. Normally for welding of pipes, if you remember, I told you SIW is used, submerged arc welding is used for welding of pipes. So you could have seen also sometimes they put the pipeline, gas pipeline. That time they take a portable SIW machine with them and they weld the pipes before putting it underground. They weld the pipes and they increase the length and then they put it inside the ground and then they cover the ground. So welding of pipe is a very important application point of welding. So requirements of ideal weld. So this we have seen. So ideally there are four requirements. First is the requirement of energy. So energy normally in form of heat should be applied so that the parts which are to be welded, they should melt and then the joint will be formed. Previously we have seen that energy is mostly obtained from arc, electric arc, or from electric resistance, or from the flame. So MEC 402, we have seen gas welding, we have seen arc welding, and we have seen resistance welding. So these three things we have seen. Also, this thing we have discussed previously, difference between fusion and melting. Whenever we say fusion, it means melting plus union, that even after melting, some joint is being formed. But melting is means just it is melting and then it is going away. Afterwards, the part may or may not be joined. So whenever we say welding, so we say welding is a fusion process. We don't say welding is a melting process, right? Because after melting, joining has to be achieved. So welding is a fusion process. Then next is cleaning action. The parts which are being joined, they should be cleaned before the welding. It should be free from contaminants. So cleaning can be achieved through chemical action, through sputtering of an arc, or by mechanical means like scrubbing. So mechanical means like scrubbing is the most common form of cleaning. Very easily done, very cheaply done. Chemical action also is a sort of cheap, not as cheap as scrubbing, but still cheap. Sputtering using an arc is very high-end process. We'll discuss it while talking about EBW and LBW, laser beam welding, electron beam welding. That time before welding, the surfaces has to be cleaned through sputtering. So sputtering is basically a physical phenomena in which the part which has to be cleaned, it is placed inside a sputtering chamber, and then argon ions are made to sputter on it. So argon ions, they clean away whatever contaminants are there, they sputter it away. So try to picturize it. Suppose you have a series of marble, and on the marble you throw a football. So the football will come in and it will sputter away the marble. This is the physical significance of the term sputtering. So argon atom is like a football, which is heavy, which is bigger in size, and the contaminants are smaller in size and lighter in weight. So when the argon atoms are made incident on the contaminants fly away, sputter away. So that is the cleaning. This is a very simple example of the common chemicals. I have given two chemicals, acetone and IPA, isopropyl alcohol. These are very commonly available in market, nothing special here. Right, this is the wire brush. So wire brush, traditional wire brush is like this. It is a handheld wire brush, looks like a toothbrush, but bigger than toothbrush, much more dangerous than toothbrush. This type of brushes you could have seen in household also. Normally for cleaning the gas burners, we used to have such type of brushes. But if you are welding any MS plate, it is advisable that you take such type of brush and then you scrub whatever lint and dirt and rust is there, you can scrub it off, right? The another variant of wire brush is like this. These type of wire brushes can be fixed inside a handheld drill. And then when you switch on the drill, these brushes will rotate at a very higher RPM. And then you can bring it in contact with the objects, with the work pieces which are to be cleaned, and then the dirt will go off. So this is an example of aluminium before cleaning and after cleaning. These are, of course, not my images. I have taken it from the internet. And yeah, disclaimer, I forgot to mention. All these images are used for educational purposes only and not for any commercial benefits, right? So this aluminium before cleaning, after cleaning. So before cleaning, you can see such type of oxides are there on top of the aluminium. And after cleaning, this aluminium becomes like this. So this type of cleaning can be achieved with these sort of brushes. If you fix it on a hand and drill and then you move it over the surface, very fine aluminium will come up. Now, if you leave it for some time, suppose you cleaned the aluminium, then you thought, okay, I'll go out and have some water and come back. You go out, have some water, then you start talking with some friend, and then you come back in the lab. Again, aluminium oxide will be formed. Again, it will be not this much bad, but it will not be this much clean also, right? So this is a big problem with aluminium welding. This is the reason aluminium welding is sort of difficult. If you see the laptops and the mobiles by Apple, they use aluminium body. So even they try to minimize the welding of aluminium. You will see most of the time they machine the aluminium and then they try to join it using some industrial grade glue. They don't go for welding of the aluminium because even they could not perfect it till now. Most of the patents of aluminium machining are in the name of Apple company or nowadays some other laptop manufacturers also. So that is one thing. Aluminium welding is a difficult thing, which we are still trying to figure out. Okay, way to exclude the atmosphere. So way to exclude the atmosphere means you have cleaned the surface, started the welding, Now from the atmosphere, some contaminant should not enter the weld zone. So how can we do it? We can do it by two ways. Either you can use the flux, means the coating of the electrode. You may be remembering from the previous, from MEC 402. The coating of the electrode, it will dissociate and it will generate some gases. Or you can have a gas shielding also. So here, this is the action of flux. So we have an electrode wire. We have the electrode coating. We have struck an arc. That due to the heat of the arc, the workpieces are being melted. Also, the electrode coating is being disintegrated and it is generating a lot of gases. Normally, for generating gas, we put cellulose inside the electrode, which is a very common component. So cellulose disintegrates and releases a lot of heat. Of course, releases a lot of gas. These gases are not very good for health. So you should wear proper mask. And nowadays, everyone is wearing mask even without welding also. So that is other thing, which is good. You should always wear mask while welding. But we didn't used to pay attention to this previously. But now we'll be paying attention, which is good. Okay. Another way for shielding is by using a shielding gas. So very common example is GMAW. So here we have the electrode. We have the contact tube. Electrode is coming from behind. And this is the welding arc. This is the shielding gas, which is shielding the welding arc. Now, different types of shielding gases we have seen. We have seen argon. We have seen helium. We have seen what will happen if you use helium. So if you remember, if you use helium, the bead width will be more. Penetration will be less. If you use argon, the effect will be reversed. Why these things are there, we have discussed previously. I ask you to just go through those notes also. Okay, this is an image which is taken from this research paper, which is fairly recent, 2018 research paper. This is the actual image. This is the image of the actual welding. GMAW welding was there. So how does it look? This is taken through a thermal cameras. Thermal cameras are very costly. This such type of images, some studies they wanted to make. I don't know what sort of study, and we are not interested also. The study was more in the what type of vortexes are forming when the gases are coming at 15 liters per minute, what sort of vortex we are seeing. The gases are coming at 6 liters per minute, what sort of vortexes can be expected, that sort of thing, right? And lastly, the weld, the joint which has formed, it should be metallurgically satisfactory, means there should be complete continuity. This we have discussed earlier. The base metal and the welded zone, it should not be distinguishable. There should be complete continuity. Then we can say that the joint is metallurgically satisfactory. So classification of welding we'll see today, and we'll stop for today. This is being the first lecture, and already we have discussed so many things. Okay, so classification of welding, this we have seen previously also. Flame-based welding means oxyacetylene welding or oxy-welding process. Electric arc welding could be shielded metal arc welding, gas metal arc welding, gas tungsten arc welding, submerged arc welding, electroslag welding, electro-gas welding, plasma arc welding, atomic hydrogen welding, and flux core arc welding. So these processes, the bold ones, we'll see today, this class. Electric resistance, spot welding, seam welding, projection welding, flash spot welding, offset welding, we have done earlier. Radiant energy, electron beam, ultrasonic welding, and laser beam welding process. These things also we'll do this time. So I want to stop here for today. And if any questions are there, if you guys want to talk about anything or ask anything, you can ask. Next class, we'll do SMAW, GMAW, GTAW, and SAW. These four processes we took one semester previously. Not one semester, we took 3-4 lectures, maybe 4-5 lectures. But this time we'll do it in one lecture. Because we have done it, we are just recapping it. Okay, so I'll stop here for today. And next class, when I finish it, then I'll send you the PPT. Okay, if anything you want to ask or anything you want to talk about, we can have it now. Anything, anyone wants to ask anything, you can ask, sir.
Sir.
Bolo.
Yeah. স্যার বলছি যে আমাদের অনেকজনের ইংরাজিতে বললে ভালো হয় স্যার So can we get a PDF copy of the notes from you?
PDF copy, I'll try. I'll see whether I have it or not. I'll see it and I'll send it to you if I can locate it. Meanwhile, I request the other people, those who have the notes with them, if they can share, that also is okay, no?
Yeah, that is okay, sir. But right. So you did your building class in the fourth semester, so that's why I asked.
Yeah, I'm requesting the others, those who are here, who are listening, and if they have the notes with them, please share it. You can upload it in the team, you know, MS Team portal is there. You can upload it there or do one thing, just email it to me, whatever you have with you, and I will upload it in the MS Team portal. There you can see the notes. And then you can recap it.
Okay.
Anything else?
Sir, can you please scroll back the 20 slides that you taught so that we can check it out whether we have to ask anything or not?
Okay, I'll scroll
it would be back.
Better,
especially last 10 slides.
Okay, so this was the syllabus. You stop me when you want to ask something, right? This is syllabus slide 1, syllabus slide 2. This is something which I made, a portion we won't be discussing, so I didn't want to discuss this slide also. This is the welding definition, what is meant. Yes. This is the example of bed weld, MS pieces welded together. These are stainless steel pieces welded together. This is welding of pipes having a fillet joint. This is the requirements of the welding processes. Four requirements are there. So first one is energy is required. Second is surface cleaning should be done. So here I have discussed that cleaning can be done through chemical action or through sputtering of an arc and through mechanical scrubbing. Out of these chemical action and scrubbing, I have shown some images. Means next slide, I have shown you that acetone and isopropyl is chemical cleaning. This is scrubbing cleaning. Cleaning through sputtering, I have just talked about. I have not shown you any images or the notes because we'll discuss it in detail while talking, while discussing EBW and LBW. Those things we'll talk this in detail. Sputtering cleaning we'll talk in much more detail. That's why I have not shown anything here. Just an analogy I have told, that sputtering is done through argon atom. So you can visualize argon as a football and you can visualize the contaminant atom as marble, very small marbles. So when the football is hitting the row of marble, the marble will be moved out. So this is the physical analogy of a sputtering. We'll discuss it in detail later. Okay, this is the scrubbing cleaning of aluminium before cleaning and after cleaning. So before cleaning, it is looking like this. If you normal aluminium pieces, if you see, will look like this. And this is after cleaning. Then
so why welding of aluminium is so difficult?
Welding of aluminium is difficult, sir, because it tends to form the oxides very quickly. So this is the welding, this is the scenario of aluminium surface before cleaning. This is after cleaning, but these things are at room temperature. The tendency to combine with oxygen, it goes up as the temperature goes up. So if you try to do welding, definitely temperature will go up. And as the temperature goes up from atmosphere, it will try to take in the oxygen and will tend to form aluminium oxides. So welding of aluminium is, that's why it is a difficult thing. That's why mostly for welding of aluminium, GMAW is recommended. Because GMAW shielding gases will be coming, it will exclude the atmosphere out. Another thing, if you have a lot of money, you can go for welding in a vacuum. But that time, welding in a vacuum, striking an arc will be difficult. So if you do welding in a vacuum, you have to go for electron beam welding. We'll see what is meant by electron beam welding. We'll talk a little about space welding also. In space, normally welding is done through electron beam only because in space gases won't be there. So arc initiation is very, very difficult. Either you have to use a very high voltage or you have to go for electron beam welding. So welding of aluminium is difficult because high temperature, it tends to combine with oxygen. So you can have two methods to weld aluminium. Either you go for GMAW, you put in a lot of gases and shield it, or you go for vacuum welding. Okay. Next, I have talked about ways to exclude the atmosphere can be done through gases from flux. So these are the gases generated from the flux. Normally, cellulose is used for generating gases, or it can be done through shielding. you supply shielding. So GMAW is one. GTAW is also another method. There also you supply the inert gases. This slide I have taken from what happened is I was looking for some images of shielding gases flow. So I found this figure. Then I traced back and found that it belongs to a journal. So I've given the reference here. What I want to show you is this is how it looks from a thermal camera. If you put in the shielding gases, this is how it will look. Okay. Then fourth requirement of an ideal weld is should be metallurgically satisfactory. Means there should not be any distinction. You should not be able to distinguish that here welding has been done, here welding is not been done. Then next up is classification of welding process. This we have seen previously also. So flame welding types, electric arc welding type, electric resistance welding type, and radiant energy welding. So these are the types. So we are stopping here.
Sir, okay. I have one question.
Yeah. Yes, please.
Sir, it might not be related to the syllabus. Sir, you told about space welding, right? Is absence of atmosphere or particles. That makes it difficult for spark initiation. Can't we create an artificial atmosphere at the time of welding instead of
creating going to sir, you will see creating an artificial atmosphere is much more difficult than using an electron gun. Because how will you create an artificial atmosphere? Suppose you are working at a Hubble telescope. You have seen the movie Gravity. Gravity movie dekhi hai?
No, sir.
Dekh lena.
ठीक है सर देख
कोई भी मूवी देख लेना एपोलो 13 देख लेना टॉम हैंक ये ग्रेविटी मूवी देख लेना सैंड्रा बुलक जॉर्ज क्लूनी वाली तो यू विल गेट एन आईडिया कि मतलब हाउ इज द सिनेरियो आउट देयर यू आर फ्लोटिंग इन हबल टेलीस्कोप यू आर फ्लोटिंग आउटसाइड द हबल टेलीस्कोप एंड यू आर गोइंग फॉर रिपेयरिंग ओवर देयर यू सी अ स्मॉल क्रैक इज देयर नाउ यू आर फ्लोटिंग इन अ जीरो ग्रेविटी सिचुएशन द हबल टेलीस्कोप इज स्पिनिंग अराउंड द अर्थ एट एन इनक्रेडिबली फास्ट वेलोसिटी नाउ यू हैव टू डू वेल्डिंग. So that time, if you want to create an atmosphere, how do you create? You have to put 70% nitrogen, 20% oxygen, and some other traces. Then you can generate the rather than doing that, if you take an electron gun, so electron beam welding principle is the electrons travel at a very high velocity. They impinge on the workpiece. The kinetic energy of the electrons gets converted into heat energy and the workpiece.
Heat energy, yes.
So this is how electron gun works. So using an electron gun is expensive but easier. And for space missions, money is not an issue. They can have so much of money, right? So
sir,
this is one thing. Yeah.
Okay, sir.
Yeah.
Actually, I was thinking about International Space Station and all. Like there, it might be possible. So I thought, sir, I didn't have any idea about it.
Might be possible, you have to see the cost benefit also. Atmosphere, you have to first make that region airtight. That also you have to do so that whatever atmosphere you are creating, the atmosphere should go out. One thing which you can do, which I believe can be done, is rather than creating an atmosphere, if you can supply some gas, electrons are being emitted from the gun, and now if you can supply some continuous supply of gas you can put, then the electrons will impinge on the gas particle and then it will ionize the gas particles. And then can be established. But whether it will be stable or not, what will be the risks, those things I don't know. Suppose arc you have established, that arc wo lag gaya at astronaut ke hi lag gaya fir. Arc mein kitna dekha hai na?
Yes sir.
Molten metal wo kya aa gaya uske oxygen pipe mein lag gaya, phat gaya oxygen fir.
Achha.
Ho sakta hai na kuch bhi.
Ji
sir. Welding bahut hi unstable process hai. Arc welding to khas kar se unstable hai. Bolo.
एक्चुअली जो सेकंड थिंग आप बताए हम वही बोलना चाहते थे पर फ्रेम नहीं कर पाए क्वेश्चन सही से एटमॉस्फेयर बोल दी
नहीं एटमॉस्फेयर
फिर भी सर एक्सप्लेनेशन अच्छा था सर समझ
वो बोल सकते हो लेकिन उस पर रिसर्च क्या हुआ है मेरे को पता नहीं मेरे को ये तो देखना पड़ेगा कि किसी ने कुछ काम किया है कि नहीं इसके ऊपर वैक्यूम में अंदर करके ट्राई कर सकते हैं लेकिन वैक्यूम बनाने का खर्चा कौन देगा महंगा आता है वैक्यूम बनाना पड़ता है और उसे वैक्यूम वेल्डिंग इक्विपमेंट लेके जाना भी तो खुद घुसना भी तो हुआ है ना वैक्यूम में इंसान होगा बताओ
सर फट जाएगा ना सर
फट जाएगा हाँ इंसान भी फट जाएगा क्योंकि अंदर हमारा ब्लड प्रेशर है ना 120 मिलीमीटर बहुत होता है तो इंसान भी फट जाएगा तो वो रिसर्च अभी हुआ नहीं है इसके ऊपर लेकिन अभी स्पेस वेल्डिंग में अभी के समय इलेक्ट्रॉन गन यूज करते हैं अभी तक तो ये हो रहा है, थोड़ा कुछ सोच के देखो, अच्छा बना दो कुछ और बढ़िया लगेगा, फिर बोलेंगे हम लोगों ने बनाया स्पेस वेल्डिंग में, देखो इसरो वालों को बोलना फिर कि मैंने बनाया एक वेल्डिंग का। चलो और कोई कोई डाउट
सर?
ध्रुव ज्योति बोलो बोलो
सर। सर भाई माइल्ड स्टील फॉर स्टेनलेस स्टील इट इज डिफिकल्ट बट माइल्ड स्टील इट इज नॉट डिफिकल्ट टू वेल्ड।
माइल्ड स्टील इज मोर कंडक्टिव देन स्टेनलेस स्टील, दैट्स व्हाई व्हाट हीट इज बीइंग इनपुट थ्रू द वेल्डिंग आर्क it can be easily conducted away. Stainless steel heat cannot be conducted away. So what happens is, even when the welding is over, the heat is still inside the stainless steel. And due to the heat, the stainless steel will continue to expand or contract. So the welding, suppose you are making a T-joint. So making a T-joint in mild steel is easier because after the welding is done, you apply some coolant, the heat will be easily conducted away. Even without coolant, the heat will be conducted away and you can get a T-joint. One element will be horizontal, another element will be 90 degree. But same thing you want to do with stainless steel, you do the welding, heat will be concentrated, the weld bead will remain molten for a longer time. And even when it starts melting, due to the heat, the 90 degree angle, maintaining that 90 degree angle in case of a T-joint is very, very difficult. And it will tend to distort, the angle will be varied. This is one example I am giving, so it's easier to visualize. Heat is a very detrimental thing in a welding. Of course, it is needed for the welding, but it should not stay in the welded region for a longer time. Then it will tend to damage the welding process. That's why SS welding is difficult than MS welding.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Okay. Anyone else?
Sir, sir, आपने वहाँ बोला कि वहाँ good weld होगा और
SS में.
हाँ, तो आप ये भी बोल रहे हैं कि वो
अरे सुनो संदीप, मैंने ये नहीं बोला कि गुड वेल्ड होगा, मैंने बोला कि गुड वेल्ड है। मैं ये बताना चाह रहा था कि एक बंदा एमएस में भी अच्छा वेल्डिंग नहीं कर पाया, लेकिन दूसरे वाले में एसएस में भी अच्छा वेल्डिंग करके दिखा दिया उसने। मैं ये बोलना चाह रहा था
sir.
मैं ये बोलना चाह रहा था कि गुड वेल्ड हैज बीन मेड। मैं तो एग्जाम्पल दे रहा था एसएस में तो वेल्डिंग कितना मुश्किल है, लेकिन फिर भी किसी बंदे ने जो कि बहुत ही मतलब अच्छा बंदा है, अच्छा वेल्डर है, उसने एसएस में भी देखो अच्छा वेल्डिंग करके दिखा दिया। और एमएस में देखो नॉट अ गुड वेल्ड दैट हैज बीन मेड। ये वेल्डिंग मैं बोलो कि दिखाना चाह रहा कि देखो कितना गंदा वेल्डिंग किया एमएस में। एमएस में तो अच्छा कर देना चाहिए था, वो तब भी नहीं कर पाया। मैं एक एग्जाम्पल दे रहा, मैंने ये नहीं बोला कि एमएस में खराब बनेगा हर टाइम, एसएस में अच्छा बनेगा। मैं ये बोल रहा हूँ कि एमएस में अच्छा हो सकता है,